It's almost time. So welcome you all again. Hope you're having a good day. I'm Ram Prakash. I'm going to spend the next 45 minutes with you where we are going to talk about how to get AI into your everyday IT process and how to make sure it really adapts to the new normal. Right. So a few technicalities before we get into the actual content. This particular tool, Showtime, works really good on Chrome, Firefox, or Opera. So if you are on Safari, sorry about it, you could consider switching to either of these browsers. And in case you cannot see me or hear me or see the slides, most of the times a hard refresh works. But if you are not able to still, if you still have issues, feel free to hit up my colleagues in the chat section. And I'll be taking questions at the end of the webinar. So in case you have questions, use the questions option on your left-hand side of the screen to ask up any questions. I'll be taking the questions at the end. But feel free to ask whatever you have in your mind. I'll also be launching occasional polls. So when that comes up, please feel free to vote. So I hope you can hear and see me fine. Like I said, again, my friendly colleagues over there can help you in the chat section. So we can get started. Perfect. So I'm Ram Prakash. I have been leading the AI and blockchain efforts for ZohoCorp. I've been with the company for a decade now. And I started off a unit called Zoho Labs, where we do a lot of product relevant research. So we have a team that works on DB. We have a team that dedicatedly works on AI and ML. We have a team that works on blockchain. We have a team that works on hardware acceleration. So it is a kind of big unit where we give in solutions of the latest technologies in the market to our products. Right. So ZohoCorp is the parent brand for us. So ZohoCorp has three divisions. The first one is Zoho.com, which is called the operating system of business. So it's a suite of business collaboration and productivity. It has all tools for you to run your business, everything from CRM to help desk to email to online office suite. And it is again a bunch of 45 plus apps that are bundled together. And WebNMS is our IoT division. We started off as a telecom division, but later pivoted into the IoT market. And this is ManageEngine. ManageEngine is presenting you this webinar today. ManageEngine is our IT division. It was established in 2001. We have a wide array of enterprise IT management tools. So we have been around 19 plus years in the industry, 180K plus users, 3,500 plus employees, deployed across 190 plus countries, and we have 90 plus products that are on our offering. So we have a global presence. We are spread across the globe. So we are not really far away from you in any part of the world. So this is our global presence. And this is our product suite. So we have IT service management, endpoint management, security management, identity and access management, operations management, and IT analytics. Now, all of these products come up in different flavors. Like you can deploy it on your own on-premises setup, we have a cloud offering, or you can deploy it on your public cloud, right? So deployment, you have unlimited options for you to deploy the suite, and most of the apps have a mobile app as well. So all of it is sorted, right? So let us get to the meat of today's webinar. We'll be specifically focusing on the recent trends in AI and how they are going to be relevant for IT management. So a stat to start off with. 37% of organizations have implemented AI in some form. That is a 270% increase over the last 4 years. And this happens to be a 2019 research report by Gartner. But now that the pandemic has accelerated digital adoption, the number 270% is only going to increase because there has been an accelerated digital adoption because of the pandemic. So in the process, you also get a lot of data generated. So it's only fair you're going to use this data to your competitive advantage, be it in your IT back office or be it in your front office. Right? So more data means better AI, and better AI means better prediction powers, etc., which we'll be talking throughout the webinar. Right? So this is just to set the context. Like I said, Manage Engine has been around for 19 years now. And we always believe that AI is not a standalone tech. So AI adds value when it is rightly integrated with the product that we are going to work with. For example, AI in service delivery, right? AI in SAEM. It is all about integrating AI into the right place, make sure the processes you have built around it are, you know, still workable or still compliant to current government guidelines and things like that. So it's all about how well, it's not just standalone AI research. We're not a startup that is just doing something cool with AI, but instead we are trying to retrofit AI into products that have been around for decades, into users who have been using the product for decades with, and you know, it's a real long-term game. So we have built our AI stack from the ground up. We are about 150 engineers working on AI right now. And everything from the base stack. So Zoho Corp as a company does everything right from deployment. All of it is built in-house. It is deep R&D work. So we have integrated AI in the nicest of ways you can see in IT management. I'm going to walk you through in detail about all of it. Right. So intelligence, the word intelligence has really been overused over the last decade in IT management, right? The word, for example, something like a scheduled task where you say every Wednesday, 9 a.m. in the morning, you run this task. Every Monday morning, you actually clean the printer's cache, right? So you would have scheduled a lot of things and the schedule would auto run without a human intervention. And then we tagged it intelligence in the past. And you can have some function triggers where, you know, when the printer is printing more than 100 pages an hour, then probably restrict printing for the next 30 minutes and so on. So depending on the result of one action, looking at the count of one action, you can build triggers where now when your inventory is so low, you stop your asset request forms from taking data in for a while. So again, these are called intelligent function triggers where you set predefined thresholds. Like I said, the threshold alerts as well. Let's say you are getting alerts for fail logins. You say you configure an alert saying when I get more than 10 fail logins in a minute, then throw me an alert. Now, this is a sliding window, right? So it can be for a minute, it can be for an hour, it can be for a day. The window just slides and whatever count that happens within that interval, you can configure it to throw alerts. So what is new about artificial intelligence? We have been dealing with intelligence for a while. How is artificial intelligence very different? Right? Think about it. The intelligence which we talked about earlier were all programmed. The developer of your AI tool had pre-programmed it and had given you options to pitch in the numbers. For example, there would be a pre-programmed alert that said the number of failed logins in an hour. And you go enter the number 10. So all of it has been programmed or customized earlier based on the user input. But how is artificial intelligence different? Now, I'll tell you an example. You're getting, you have configured your threshold as 10 fail logins per minute, then throw me an alert. So what happens is, let's say on a Monday morning, 9 a.m., people have this little fun game where you know, they forgot their passwords over the weekend and then they do their guesswork in the morning. 10 fail logins per minute could be absolutely normal. But the same thing when it happens on a Saturday morning, 3 a.m., then somebody is actually trying to brute force into your system. Now, you can actually configure a rule saying on working days, you can do this, on holidays, you can do this. But again, there are so many edge cases that you really cannot program and add into your existing infrastructure. So this is where the new artificial intelligence comes in, where it looks at a lot of your past data and identifies what is normal at a given point of time and sets elastic thresholds. Now, this is just one aspect of AI, but the broader picture I'm trying to paint here is that your AI model looks at a lot of your past data and then it sets elastic thresholds. It sets the actionable decisions for the next step to move on and so on. So the thing is, it is not explicitly configured by a programmer or by the user of the IT management tool, but instead it looked at all your past data shapes and it started bringing in results to you, right? So I hope you should have an understanding of what AI is and how it has evolved and all. But AI has quickly caught up, especially in the consumer world, because the consumer world started off with monetization of data. We have a lot of services these days where You use the software for free, you just pay it up with your data, right? But enterprise IT is a bit different, especially, you know, when you're trying to retrofit AI into already well-oiled, well-working processes. So artificial intelligence is all about taking decisions over past data than explicitly programming them, right? So with this, we'll move forward. Maybe we can have a quick poll right now. So where are you at implementing AI in your writing process? You're considering options, or you've already started implementing, or in production? Feel free to pull in your results. 30 more seconds and we go ahead with the webinar. Right. Now let us actually talk a bit about how AI is going to change your IT processes. Traditionally, your IT processes have always been very deterministic. By deterministic, you mean, let's say you have some traditional intelligence configured outage prediction system, where you say, you know, when response time is increasing, when your cache is full, when your database has reached its connection pool limits, etc. So you would have defined a set of rules, and then your traditional intelligence would be saying, okay, rule one matched, rule two matched, rule three matched. So now there is going to be a chance of an outage. It's going to be an outage probably in some time. The standard operating procedure for this outage alert would be call the networking team, make sure, you know, alert it to the networking team, alert it to the product team, alert it to the marketing team so that they keep the social media feed updated, saying in case you face issues, we are working on it, we acknowledge the issue. And so most of the times acknowledging the issue really works, right? So you know, get your marketing channel, start with the marketing. But now AI is going to introduce a very probabilistic notion into the game. Traditionally, programmers, when programmers brute force, it was considered a really bad thing. But introduce a new category of people called data scientists and AI developers. Most of our day-to-day work is brute forcing, right? So that is how modern AI has been shaping up, where, you know, you try, it all depends on the shape of your input data, right? You will have to do a lot of trial and error experiments, which is not the same when you actually write code. You need to understand what you're doing, the data structures, the conditional statements, all of it has to be intact. But AI is very probabilistic at the creator's end. Even at the deployer's end, now let's say you are an end consumer who uses a monitoring system that has an AI-powered outage prediction module. Think about it. This AI system is going to tell you that there is a 60% chance of outage in the next hour, right? Whereas when it is at 60%, you really need not call your marketing team and ask them to update your social media feed about a potential outage, right? But when it is at 80%, you will have a different escalation matrix where, you know, the bosses of the company get to know about it, the marketing team gets to know about it so that they keep their customers informed, right? So now in your standard operating procedure or in your traditional IT process, you need to introduce this element of probability saying, hey, what do I have to do when it is 60%? What do I have to do when it is 70%? What do I have to do when it is 80%? And you look at the number of people involved. If your outage prediction system is good, it could also detect a root cause saying, hey, a potential outage is about to happen because of this network issue or because this particular machine has been down. So it is okay if you just intimate the right set of people, right? For example, the product team has nothing to do with the network management team. And the problem here is really with the network. So it can actually well define points of action and identify root causes and help people understand what the problem is. So you need to redesign your IT processes over this probabilistic fashion to better adapt to AI. And we are also moving from process automation to decision automation. We have talked a lot about process automation in the last decade, but now AI is going to take decisions. Like I said, you know, there has been a trouble in the network section. So AI will say this potential outage can be caused by this network. So it takes a decision. It looks up all your past data. So the last time you had a problem with your network, you switched it to your backup network. And now it recommends that as a decision to your IT admin saying, hey, this, the same episode on March 2020, you did this and the problem was solved. There was no downtime. So maybe it's a good idea to do this again, right? So your AI can come in and automate decisions and take decisions for you. And depending on the confidence of the decision, you can decide if the system can automatically remediate or you need a human in the loop to get things right. Now, we discussed a lot of things about how AI is shaping into the IT industry. What are the process level changes that you need to embrace to adopt AI in your organization? Now, I'm going to talk to you about the more recent trends for AI, in especially closer to IT, and how well it would translate very well to AI. Because AI, when initially developed, like I said, the commoditization of data, it was built on top of tons of data, right? For example, your search engine has click streams of data. It knows where you click. You're being tracked at a pixel level when you use a lot of things. But enterprise is going to be a different ball game. There are stricter data compliance regulations. There are stricter implications. For example, one wrong recommendation of a friend on a social network is really going to hurt. But a couple of wrong recommendations on an outage or a couple of wrong outage predictions is really going to make people turn the system off, right? So things get a lot serious when it comes to AI and IT. So we'll see how things are drifting and what are the most recent developments here. Okay, so I'm going to talk to you about a couple of interesting stories and case studies. So the first one is going to be about a horse. His name was Hans, and he was titled Clever Hans. So he was owned by a mathematics professor in Germany somewhere around 1904. I even pulled up a picture of Mr. Hans out of Wikipedia for you. So apparently the claim was this horse was so clever that it started doing mathematical operations. So you can ask the horse, what is 7 times 3? And it would tap its feet 21 times. You can ask the horse, what is 5 times 4? It would just tap its feet 20 times. Interesting, right? So this initially, threw up a lot of ripples in Germany. A lot of people came in visiting, asked a lot of mathematical puzzles to the horse. It answered everything beautifully. And then a few professors and animal psychologists from across the pond in New York, they flew in and they decided to see if this horse is really capable of something, or do animals really have the power to do mathematical computations like us. And they started testing it in a wide variety of scenarios, and interestingly, it passed everything beautifully. So they decided it is the owner of the horse, the math professor, the German math professor, who's actually giving some clues to the horse about the results, and they kicked him out of the room. Still, interestingly, it worked really well. It was still able to answer without the owner. But then this particular animal psychiatrist from New York actually decided to blindfold the horse, right? So he decided to blindfold the horse, and the horse was not able to do any mathematical operations. That's quite an interesting story, right? I'll tell you what it is about. You should have heard this fact saying correlation is not causation, right? It is a very widely used statistical one-liner where correlation is not causation. But if you see that, the horse actually looked at people's visual cues. It got a lot of visual cues from the people around. And let's say when you ask what is 5 times 3, when the horse is tapping its feet for the 14th time, everybody's eyes brims with excitement so that the horse knows when to stop. Not just the owner, but all of them in the audience. So it was able to solve any concrete mathematical puzzle thrown at it. But all of it was just by looking at the humans and their eyes and the expectations and their eye contact and things about their eye movement and their excitement and all of that. It took a lot of visual cues out of it and then stopped tapping its feet. And once when it did that, people rewarded it using, let's say they did a big round of applause, or they gave it a sweet treat and so on, right? So today's AI systems are very similar to Clever Hans, right? You should have read about automatic medical AI just looking at scan reports, and the same scan, the same, let's say it's a lung CT, the same lung CT taken from different hospitals, just the name of the hospital is different. The system gave different answers, right? So it took a lot of unnecessary cues from the input data and started taking decisions. That is how modern AI has been built upon. But there are a lot of people who are working to bring in causation, build causation first AI, or even use causation as explanation modules for current AI, right? Most of the times correlation doesn't work. For example, let's say your height and your shoe size, So the taller you are, the bigger your shoe size is. But you know, these two variables are heavily correlated. But in this case, you know that your shoe size is bigger, you are taller, and not the reverse, where you are taller because your shoe size is bigger. It doesn't work that way. But especially when it comes to IT management, things aren't that simple, because you have multi-tenant, multi-systems working in tandem with each other. And you should know, is my web response time slow because my database server is overloaded? Or is my database server overloaded because my web response time is slow, right? Or there could be a cache in the equation. There could be a backup server in the equation. There could be a storage server in the equation. Now, you need to know how these five entities work along together. So a standard example they give is like, you look at your lawn, and if it is wet, there are two things that can cause it. Either it could have rained or your sprinkler is on. So now your lawn is wet and it hasn't rained, but that infers that your sprinkler is on, right? Or the lawn is wet and the sprinkler is off, it means it rains. But then you see that there is always a 25% chance of error, where the lawn is wet, it could as well be raining and the sprinkler be on, right? So there are ways to form causal graphs, and we think in Manage Engine, we think that causation is going to play a big role in the next couple of years, especially in getting AI into IT. We are building a lot of features on top of these causal models, and most of it are live. Some of them are in the pipeline. So we'll talk about more of it when we see the examples. Okay, here comes the second interesting story. This is about the case of one Mr. Petro. So Mr. Petro was working in the defense division of Soviet Union. Soviet had built an automated missile defense system where actually sometime around in 1983, the system detected an incoming missile from the United States of America. The system was configured in such a way that whenever it detected a missile, it actually fires back to the source, right? So looking at the political climate, our man, Mr. Petro, actually found out that this was a false alarm. And he stopped the response missile. He stopped the defense attack from the Soviet Union's base towards the United States. Apparently, he was fired from his job. But then this man played an important role in preventing World War III. Right? That is quite interesting, right? So an automated system whose decision went wrong, looking at the political climate, this human understood and stopped the automatic response. Right? So we'll talk about one more story and see how the story of Mr. Petro relates to AI in IT. Right? Again, 2020, we are going to talk something about the pandemic. This was when early March or late February 2020, in Europe and in Great Britain, there was an online grocer. There was this particular online grocer who had deployed IT systems. And like everybody, people were hoarding a lot of things from online grocers. And this IT system was not really capable of understanding what is going on. And it started blocking people's requests, right? It started blocking legitimate traffic, thinking it was under a distributed denial of service attack, a DDoS attack, right? And apparently, people were trying to just hoard things and stock 6 months of toilet paper in a couple of days and things like that. But it stopped legitimate users coming in, and then it needed a human in the loop to come in and say that this is a false alarm, this is not a DDoS attack, things outside have changed. Right? So now, one thing that Mr. Petro and the online grocer tells us is that the compulsive need for a human in the loop. Right? Now think about this online grocer case, where you cannot really blame it on the IT system, because it has never been trained, or it has never looked at a black swan event of this magnitude before. And ultimately, it is very difficult to model such huge events because it is outside the scope of it. Now imagine this virus thing didn't happen at all. What would have happened? The system would have been right. Somebody is doing a DDoS attack on your system, right? This is where a lot of external events are not really modeled into your AI process, right? So this health pandemic was not really modeled into your AI model that was deployed in the DDoS prevention or DDoS mitigation system, right? So all it needed was a human in the loop who understood what the context was, who understands that people have hoarded 6 months of toilet paper, the demand for toilet paper in the next 6 months is going to be subdued, to, you know, pass on specific inputs to the system to work better. Now, the thing is, AI is here to aid and not replace, right? So whenever we talk about AI, I don't think it comes up these days, but sometime into 2017, 2018, we have a lot of questions where can AI take my job, etc. But no, AI is here to aid and not replace. AI can make better radiologists. AI can make better, missile launchers. AI can make better. Now think about it. You really cannot blame the AI system in both the cases where it hadn't really seen a condition like that. It hadn't really known. It didn't know the political climate to understand that the incoming missile would be a false alarm. Now, this can happen to anybody. So AI plus human is going to be a really, really powerful combination. That is when AI is going to get superhuman powers, when a human's idea, because you really cannot model everything in the universe. So there is a term for it. It's called artificial general intelligence. We are heading there, but at least for the next decade, I don't see autonomous AI systems coming in. I hope you would have read in the press a lot about GPT-3. It's being widely talked about now. GPT-3 is probably one good step towards the, you know, artificial general intelligence, where you read in a lot of text corpuses and frame your learning from it and then use it for other tasks. Right? So that is outside the context of this webinar, but then it has been happening and it is in the press recently. So the next thing is going to be investing in a lot of transfer learning techniques. So what is the transfer learning techniques? Most of the cases, you have very little data available. Let's say you're trying to do a sentiment analysis over your service delivery platform, right? So think about it. You will have to, especially when you go with a supervised machine learning model, where you need annotated data that has been tagged as positive and negative. You need about a minimum of 1,000 examples, right? So the sample size is a minimum of 1,000. You have 500 positive examples, 500 negative sentimented examples, and then you train a model on it. And then when an incoming email comes in, you decide in which bucket does it fall? Is it positive or negative? But apparently, the way you see, there are a lot of data sets commercially available for things like e-commerce product review, movie review, hotel reviews, flight reviews, etc. These are all available in the public domain. But you cannot, the language there is a lot colloquial and a lot of slang terms are used. But in a professional B2B setup where you write emails and then it is all recorded, things are different. We have seen a lot of cases where the content of the email was really small than the disclaimer and the signature and things like that. So ultimately, the sentiment was the one of the sentiment in the disclaimer saying, do not print this unless you need this, it's good for the environment. Yes, we still have such email signatures that come into the system. And so if you look at it, you don't have properly annotated sentiment analysis data for service delivery, right? So what you can do is you can build a lot of transfer learning techniques where you can transfer learning from the bigger hotel review data set. And then with just like probably, let's say, some 10 examples from your service delivery, you can just manually annotate 5 positive and 5 negative examples from service delivery. You can transfer the learning. So even with very little data, your model is bootstrapped from widely available public corpus, and then you get going. The next thing is about concept drift and model management. This was something we discovered a lot in the Grosser case, where the concept has drifted. Right? So the world is not normal anymore. Now think about it in IT parlance. We were all working from office. So on an usual day, your IT system would expect 20% of work from home traffic and 80% of work from office traffic. Right? But all of a sudden, the concept drifted and you see 100% of people working from home. Right? And hopefully, probably in the near future, it is going to go back and stay at like 50-50. But then these concepts have drifted. The speed at which a concept drifts is very important. Now think about it. The way we socialized sometime in 2007, 2008 was very different, right? So we all forwarded emails which had funny stuff. We all forwarded emails with a lot of HTML content, GIFs, greetings, etc. But today, nobody forwards you an email from a fun user group which has a lot of jokes and things like that. We have a lot of other platforms to do it, right? You have your social networks. You have a lot of places where you share memes and things like that. But interestingly, the concept drifted very slowly, right? So you look today and you look yesterday, there would be no obvious way in which you are, you know, the concept is drifting. But then all of a sudden you look 2 years back, you are doing things totally differently, right? Think about these spam emails we would get in 2008, 2009. Probably it would say, I have inherited a lot of property from a particular king and I want to share my wealth with you. Today nobody sends those emails, right? Today's spamming happens more in the form of OTP attacks and phishing attacks, where you're given a link from the bank and then you click enter your bank credentials and then they steal your money. So things have changed. But if you look at it, that change is not very well defined. It has changed over a long period of time. You should make sure the models are trained in such a way that it still stays relevant. And there can be certain challenges that are very unique to IT management. This is where the AI is specific to IT. One, IT has a lower data retention period. Now think about it. Think about your payroll software. It has all the data of the salary and the other tax split up that has been paid to you ever since you joined the ARC. That is from the start of time. But let us talk about your internet access logs. In our SIEM and monitoring tools, we see that the retention period is most likely 4 weeks. On an average, like the biggest amount is 4 weeks, where you just have 4 episodes of weekly data and then you just dump it. It could be due to storage reasons or the complaints does not need to have things more than 4 weeks. And so on a given day, your access to data is very limited, right? So you have a really low data retention period. And in general, AI, they say more the data, better the prediction, but that may not be true because you just have limited data and you need the highest quality of predictions that are available, unlike a consumer setup. Right. And then you have fewer computing resources, so you can have on-premises deployment where I really cannot ship a GPU to you to run my fancy neural network on it to take decisions. And especially in an on-premise setup where your system is already under stress when, let's say, you're processing a huge log flow rate of, let's say, some 1,000 logs per second. And apparently, I don't want my AI process to be a memory hog or a CPU hog on top of it and then create some issues there. And of course, high business implications, like I said, slow as the new down, right? If your user experience is bad, then it not only causes you a monetary loss, it also causes a huge reputational loss. And so whenever somebody is building AI specific to IT, it has to be explanation ready. Remember, we talked about causation and things like that. It has to be, but today's explanation is more of an afterthought. The model is still built on correlative assumptions, and then the causation part is added as an afterthought. But now a lot of models are being generated where they're very causation first, right? One, and it has to be low data tech, like we said, investing in tools like transfer learning, which can borrow the bigger stuff available from outside and then funnel it into your small domain where you have very little data. And your IT has to be proactive, of course. You really cannot say a DDoS attack has happened. You should be warning the IT admin well before that attack is going to happen. And of course, there are a lot of the first use case we took up in ManageEngine was alert fatigue reduction. The case I was telling you, Monday morning 9 a.m. versus Saturday morning 3 a.m. where you log in, and now there is an alert fatigue that comes into the admin who's monitoring it. Now think about it. Let's say you have this process where you log into the firewall, then you log into a particular landing machine, then you touch a set of certain resources. Now you get 3 alerts for this, but actually you can just summarize it into one login event where this particular legal user has logged into the firewall, then he touched this landing machine, then he touched the set of resources, and probably he has read-only permission, so he did it. Now, if you look at it, there are some frequent patterns. Then there could be some rare patterns, something like a monthly cron job or a monthly cleanup job where you log in and do it. I have seen it, but it is not very frequent. So that can be some yellowish, like think of the first one as green, the second one as yellow. And then there could be unseen events, which means somebody didn't or somebody skipped a part. Somebody reached the firewall and then without touching the landing server, he started deleting a few things or he started a repeated execution on a particular asset. So, you need to bring in a lot of alert fatigue reduction, alert summarizing, saying these are all less prior alerts. Setting elastic thresholds would also do this, right? You don't want a Monday morning, 3 failed logins per minute alerts to really come in and bother you. But Saturday morning, 3 a.m., it's going to be really important. And with the advent of cloud, we are seeing a lot of quick changes happening in the system, right? Scaling in and scaling out is as simple as a jiffy. And so your IT system should not be resistant to change, right? So this is how a typical enterprise IT infrastructure look like. You have three components, the security and the endpoint monitoring component, the monitoring component, and then the service delivery component. We'll stop for a quick poll. So which of these IT process do you think will reap most of AI's benefits? So these inputs could really help us prioritize the next big thing we are going to work on. So now let us take a deep dive into the security component. This is a screenshot from ManageEngine's user behavior analysis from the SAEM product. Now, if you can see the portion in red where I've highlighted, it says overall anomalies 26, insider threats 12, data exfiltration 26, compromise accounts 13. Now, this UEBA thing is a really hot thing in the market right now, where you look at your user and entity behavior and then bring in some consolidated reports. You can also see that there's a risk score assigned to the user and the number of anomalous events that has happened over the last few days, and sort users by their risk score, etc. So this is the dashboard. Right? And this is about an entity's behavior. You see that an unusual host startup has occurred, and you can see the explanations over there. Right? It says it happened between 6 and 7 p.m., but I expected it to happen between 8 and 9 a.m. So the human in the loop can really validate, and it also gives a confidence score, which says 100. It's actually in percentage. So it also gives you a confidence score of how well the system has predicted. Now, for example, you can automate, like I said, bringing in a probabilistic element would mean you can configure rules saying if the confidence is 100, then do these corresponding remediative actions and so on. Right? This is again from the SAEM's UEBA module. So you can see that there are some time-based anomalies. Like I said, we can come in a different set of shifts. Let's say we are shift employees. Now, you need not configure the details of the shift details of every person in your org, but instead, by looking at their past login data, I can say this particular user accesses this particular resource at this point in time. And now, even if their shift changes, you need not do any manual reconfiguration, but the system itself understands that at a certain point of time, he has stopped logging into during his old shift time. Now he is logging in at the new shift time. So you just start adopting it to the newer shift time so that you reduce the number of false positives. You can also see the warning there. The detection engine has been trained only for 3 days. It starts really working well after 7 days because it has to at least see an episode. Now, let's say you work on Tuesdays and Fridays. So you cannot expect, once you have logged in on Tuesday, and let's say only when it comes to the next Tuesday and you log in, it understands that there is a pattern, there is a seasonal trend to it, etc. Right? So again, all of these are on-premise, so they are really small and beautiful AI tech that can work with low amounts of computing power and low amounts of data. It can still work with, coexist with your existing on-premise setup, no need for any fancy hardware. Right? And you have here we are just looking at count-based anomalies, like the example we discussed a while before, the number of failed logins, right, across the org or on a particular machine, etc. Right. Now, there could also be pattern-based anomalies where, like I said, user logs into a firewall, then comes to a landing machine, then accesses a certain set of resources. You have a frequent pattern, you have a rare pattern, and you have an unseen pattern, right? Sometimes frequent patterns can also be issues, right? Something is happening very frequently, a series of events are happening together very frequently, and a big outage happens after that. Now you can actually causate that to this series of frequent events that are happening. So sometimes frequent events are like the green ones, and sometimes unseen events are the red ones, and sometimes they interchange their roles as well. This is from our malware analysis tool, where we do a static analysis on, let's say, an exe file, look at what all the system calls does it make. And then there is a model that is trained on the publicly available malware data sets out there, where you know that the behavior of malware just by applying a classification module, we'll be able to say if a PDF attachment or an EXE is going to be a malware or not. Right. And yeah, here comes the chatbot, where you can now all of most of the SAEM and user behavior monitoring comes under statistical machine learning. But this is where natural language processing comes in. This is from our endpoint management product, Desktop Central, where you can actually interact with the system via the chat app. So I see chat apps similar to mobile and web apps, right? So in mobile apps, you have an interface where you can do certain things. At the same time, like the trend is going to be a lot of chat apps where you can interact with one assistant. So we have branded it Zia, so we call it Zia. Across the whole corp, you can actually interact with Zia. It's a chatbot, and you can do a few actions via your chatbot. In more confidence areas, especially like in Desktop Central, you can actually apply patches via just the chat app, right? So it means it also does write. So it does write applications, and it can trigger a lot of series of events, right? So we'll break for a quick poll here. That is the end of the security component. Which of the AI features in SAEM space do you think would be most helpful for your organization? The options are user entity behavior analysis, auto-alert thresholding, or a chatbot. Now let us take a deep dive into the monitoring component. This is a screenshot from Site247, our on-cloud monitoring product. You see that this is an anomaly dashboard where we say that there has been a 1.3 times increase in page load. It is somewhere around 32K milliseconds, but we actually expected just 25K milliseconds, right? And you also see that the anomalies are tagged likely and confirmed. So you can automate based on these, like anything with more than confidence of 80% would be called confirmed. You can build your processes around it. You can build your remediation modules around it. And it also helps the system to learn better. For example, let's say there's a likely anomaly, and then you can go give a feedback to the system saying this is not at all an anomaly, and the system would learn it. And this is the monitoring dashboard, and we were talking about the alert fatigue reduction, right? So you see that the noise has been reduced by 91%. Where things have been summarized, they have been crunched. You might need those individual alerts for different compliance requirements, but still for the user who takes actions by looking at the monitoring dashboard, summarized alerts can really be helpful. Like I said, we have made sure we crafted this particular AI feature with an eye for accuracy, because if I'm missing out something while summarizing, the results are going to be disastrous. This has been heavily tested, and we are continuously investing on this particular. And this again is you can actually query your monitoring component, where you can do a sum by severity and just a visual representation of it. And you're actually forecasting your disk usage. This is again from Site247. So you are actually forecasting the swap usage. So not all forecasting is incremental trends, but you can also do decremental trends. We have a really powerful forecasting engine that adapts. In case you have more computing power and more data, it adapts to making use of that. In case you have limited computing power and limited amount of data, it is elastic enough to adapt to it. So here comes the on-premise monitoring setup. This is from our product called Op Manager. You can see that when would the disk threshold reach 80%, 90%, and 100%, so that you can plan your inventory and clean up activities accordingly. And again, this is about forecasting the events that happened in your system. You can see that you can forecast it for a wide array of periods. For example, when you do a 1 month forecasting, you know that there could be certain businesses where the end of the month, especially when your sales, a lot of activity happens. Start of the month, things are dull. There could be patterns that are day specific. For example, in a day, you know the first half of the day is going to be a lot of traffic or a lot of events happening. And so the pattern differs when you look at it from a day versus week of the day, hour of the day versus week of the day versus month versus quarter, etc. Right, so we don't zoom it more than the quarter level, but you can see that you can forecast events up to 2 years. this even works with very limited data. You know, even if you're archiving all of your past data, it just learns the crux and then is able to forecast up to 2 years and or even a custom range. This again is from our flow packet analyzer, NetFlow analyzer, where you can see the pattern. Now, interestingly, you can see that the model has absolutely learned the shape of the incoming packets and outgoing packets. You can see that the shape M is being forecasted, right? So this again works on-premise. It works with very less computing power, right? So we will break for a poll now. Which of the features in monitoring space do you think would be most helpful to your organization? Event prediction, root cause analysis, statistical forecasting, and cross correlation. Event prediction could be, you know, something even big. It could be outage prediction, where or trouble prediction, where you don't really need to take action once the event has happened, but you can, you know, foresee events and then take corrective measures right away. All right. Thank you for voting. We'll go to the last section, the service delivery component. Right, so interestingly, the first slide that comes in service delivery is going to be natural language processing, because it involves a lot of human interactions. It is a tool just to, you know, keep track of all the human interactions that has happened over the past, unlike your monitoring and security, where it is either entity-entity interaction or a human-entity interaction. Right. Here, it is a human-human interaction. So you need to apply a lot of standard natural language processing techniques. For example, you can do an asset request via the asset request form. I can drop in an email, please give me a new MacBook Pro. Somebody else can say, please give me a laptop with Mac operating system. Apparently, all of it has to be tagged with asset request as the category. Right? Even though the words asset request are not explicitly present in the email, they'll have to understand the context and say, OK, this is an asset request. And they are asking for this particular kind of asset. Now, let's say I need a laptop with 64 GB of RAM. I need a MacBook with 32 GB of RAM, and so on. Right? It is also tightly connected to the inventory module, where you know what all is in stock. And in case they are going like below the set threshold in your inventory, then you can actually see by looking at the past lead times of similar purchases, it can recommend saying it is high time you start doing a purchase request right now. So it is very natural language processing intensive. So here you can see a chatbot in action. You can also see the Zia logo there. It is available on cloud right now. On-premise version is in the works. You'll get it soon. This is the on-premise version of STP, Service Test Plus. And you can see that just by looking at the email, should you reopen a ticket, should it be approved or not? Now, let's say I raise an asset request with my boss and copy, and my boss says, yes, please grant it, right? Even before a human reads it and says to process this approval asset request, approval for the asset request, now STP's AI engine can actually say that it has been approved, and it need not wait for that human element, and your human agent can really concentrate on a lot of things that really need his attention. So here you can see that it has been auto-rejected, and the reason is also given. You can see that the budget is exceeding. Right, so this is what we are talking about, explainable and causal AI. And again, this is when you raise a ticket in your service desk, again, in the on-premise version, you can actually say, like after you have keyed in certain details, it suggests it's going to be a printer problem, right? By looking at your subject, printer is not working. It has tagged it under the printer problem category. And this is another service request where you're trying to, you know, set up a VPN account for yourself. So it automatically tags the corresponding thing, and the association rules are automated based on that. For example, I am somebody who takes care of all the VPN issues. My colleague takes care of the printer issues and so on. So first is auto tagging of the ticket raised or the incoming email. Second is auto assigning it to the right people. You can see that here where we say these are the top three people who can, whom this request can be assigned. It also takes into consideration the number of open tickets available. What would be the fastest time to resolve, or whom should I, assign to that? There would be a lot of, equation here, but you need not define everything just by looking at the past data. It knows that one particular ticket from X about a thing called Y is better done when assigned to Z, given Z's current day's load, given Z's availability, etc. Right? So that again is the on-premise version again. So we'll do a quick poll for service delivery before we go to the last slide. The last slide of the deck. Now think about it. The power that this can, you know, bring in when AI is fully unleashed across your suite of IT management products. You don't actually look at AI as you know, something that you can buy off the shelf and then disintegrate it. But AI needs to be, you know, homegrown, tightly coupled to your current products, because AI actually erodes a lot of data boundaries, and that is when the value of AI comes out, right? So your SAEM detects an unusual traffic surge. Your monitoring system also looks at it and says it is going to predict an outage, because the past few episodes where you had unusual traffic, you ended up in an outage. And then it also identifies a root cause, saying a particular traffic from a particular geography is causing this root cause. Now, there could be external elements tied to it. For example, there could have been a powerful marketing campaign that went out in that particular region, or there could have been some some unusual activity or things like that happening. For example, this is an interesting story. So we had a OCR module that would, you know, actually scan text. We had this particular offline app. So the OCR functionality is disabled when the app is offline. There was a particular geography where mobile networks collapsed for about 6 hours. And after the sixth hour, all of the traffic came online at the same time, right? And the OCR server went bust. So it didn't really expect such a traffic because everything was being done online. And at the moment, everybody synced up online and things went bust. So this could be a case like that. And your monitoring system actually pushes it into service desk, and it assigns to the right person, because the last time similar outages happened, the agent is the one who does it with a high level of success. So you do it. And your service desk also looks at the contextual remediations you have done in the past. And let's say the answer is adding more servers to that particular geography for the time being. And again, at the back office, it still looks at the inventory and say, okay, you have enough number of servers, but this is your lead time. You will have to need a minimum of so many number of servers in your inventory. So it is better you purchase or you raise a PO on or before this date. So this is the envisioning of a tightly integrated AI-powered IT. We are getting there. We are, like I said, the specifications for AI and IT, it's a niche, actually. It has to work with very little data, very little computing power. Things change a lot very constantly, unannounced. There is, you know, you can't really observe a pattern over a day. So it has to be smart enough to understand what has changed, or it has to be smart enough to realize if something has changed. That realization would be a big thing. And we also talked a lot about correlations, not causation. We talked about the need for human in the loop, where AI plus human can give you, you know, superpowers. So that's it from me. Here is a link to download a Manage Engine Solutions guide. Now, if you have any questions for me, please feel free to throw it up in the question section. Okay, here comes the first question. Just project it to you. What is the licensing pattern for AI features? Right, so we are not in the idea of devising a separate licensing strategy for AI, but today the middle variant and the enterprise variants have AI features enabled. So the idea is not about, you know, having a separate pricing strategy for AI, because like I said, we believe in AI plus X. It is widely available in the middle and the, for example, let's say we have a root cause triggering feature, and the way it is priced is you can actually consistently check for, you know, issues and then do a root cause. That is in the highest variant. The middle variants get where you can go call for a root cause analysis and then get it happen. So the pricing is that there's no separate AI level pricing that is available on there, and we don't have any plans for pricing AI separately. Right. So one more question. Hope you can see this. Will I have to deploy special hardware in my on-premises setup to enable AI functionality? No. Most of the AI or all of the AI we ship on premises today don't need any specialized hardware. Specialized hardware needs come in, especially, let's say, when there's a computer vision use case, which needs some fancy neural networks to be run. And even that, the training of the neural network is heavy, but the inference part on neural network is pretty light. So, no, as on date, there is no need for any special hardware to be deployed in the on-premises setup. Perfect. So, any more questions? Okay, I don't see any more questions. All right, thank you very much for joining. So my friendly colleagues will, you know, share the presentation material with you, and feel free to reach us for any help you need or any other requirements you have or any special AI requests you have. We shall be glad to hear from you. Thank you again for coming in on a beautiful Wednesday, and hope you're staying safe. Thank you. Goodbye.